I'm going to ask Mom to come up and give us a few announcements. Just for us, we're inviting the church to come to our house. It's a small little house, and so, but it's the heart that matters, right? So if some of you haven't even seen our place, I think Rebecca has printed out copies of the map, so if you don't know where it is. But the only thing we ask is don't park in the cul-de-sac. It's kind of like a trap. You go in there, and you'll be stuck. So it's 5 o'clock today, and we have food, simple food, so that a big crowd, maybe the entire church would come, and would become a fire hazard. We'll ask Bob Stefan to be the fire chief. But anyway, Matt, can you come up and give us some announcement of the tubing trip and so on?
Hello guys, now we are having a sponsored tubing trip on the 23rd of June, and pretty much registration is due today. If you do want to go, please see one of us, and if you still haven't asked your parents, please do so. It's open to all of us in here. If any one of you guys are under the age of 18, we do need a permission slip from you guys, okay? If you want to go, please have this filled out, signed by your parents, and bring it back to us before we go on the trip, because we, you know, want to be safe and all that and don't want to have anything to happen to any one of us. So please ask your parent about it. The trip is actually $20 now instead of $40. So it lowered them half price, okay? So this is to help everybody to come, and the church is sponsoring half. So please try your best to come so we can have a fun and enjoyable time with one another. We're also going to have some fundraising coming up in June the 3rd and pop 2 weeks later and June the 17th, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, we're going to have some fundraising. June 3rd, we're going to do some coconut jelly than we usually do. Hopefully that will bring us some profit and, you know, sponsor more to the trip. We can have some good food. If not, we're going to have some burger. Your choice. Either barbecue or burger, one of those. And then another one, maybe on the 17th, we're going to do some car wash. And also, speaking of the June 17th, we're going to have Father's Day, crawfish boil fest too. We're going to have some competition with the ministry group in the church. So form your group. If you want to join this competition, I heard there will be prizes for the winners. So if you think you have the skills and the talent of cooking crawfish, please form a group and challenge the other groups. Okay? Alright, I think that's it for our announcement. And we also have a combined service for graduation for the Sunday school to go into your next class. Rise and pray for our offering. Please stand for our prayer for the offering. Father, once again, we give praise and honor to you, Lord, to bless us to be here, to allow us to be here, to praise you, to worship you with all hearts, Lord. May you be with us as we just come and listen to your words. May your word renew us, remind us to live our lives for you, Lord. May we live a life that others see us and see you, not just us doing the work, but you enthroning us and empower us to do your work and your will, Lord, so that your name will be glorified, so that those who see us as a living testimony for you. Lord, we want to praise you once again for Vicky to return to us safely for her work in Taiwan. Lord, may you just be with her and continue to bless her and just keep her safe so she can have more opportunity to do your bidding, Lord. Lord, we once again come to you with this small offering, Lord, as you have taught us to come and to give our tithing to you. May we use this money to further your kingdom, to build your buildings, Lord, and just to help us to be a part of your ministry, Lord. We give praise to you, Lord. We just pray you bless those who have the heart, Lord, and those who are in need of you. May you come and be the provider, because we know that you are our provider in all needs, Lord. You made all our needs. We praise you, Lord. We thank you. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, what I'd like to do is invite Bill Vicky. Is she? Yeah, Bill Vicky can come up. struggling in Taiwan. And so she'll share a little bit more, but let's take a look at the video. What?
You can share first, we'll get the video afterwards.
Appreciate it.
So, hello everybody. Thank you for supporting our mission both in Taiwan. When I go to Taiwan, I see a lot of Chinese ladies who usually study very well about teenager, but they marry Taiwanese very old and handicapped. So their lives live in the house, cannot get out of the house, stay inside like a housewife, just cooking, stay home cooking, and cannot get out. Cannot go out of the house. So that's why when we come, we need to come to their house to share the gospel, read the Bible together. And sometimes we need to call them, go to the park, like the yard close to their house to study Bible. Because inside the house, the husband doesn't want like when you read the Bible, something like this. And so I show the video from the beginning. At first this is the pastor who prayed for me before I go home. And so this video shows us about a lady who is in the jail. This is the high speed train. The lady, she had to marry Taiwanese, have a children, and the children cannot speak Vietnamese, they speak Taiwanese. And this is her husband is much older than the ladies. And this is a pastor, one pastor in Taiwan. These are the ladies that worship inside the house. They don't have the church. And this is me, I just show about, this is a pastor, one pastor. Sometimes he comes to visit. He's a pastor at another church, a Taiwanese church. This is a share gospel with the lady. I came to the shop, and share gospel as I believe. Every place I show the things I believe and accept the Lord. And I take a picture. So they accept the Lord, they pray. So this girl. She loved the Lord and go with study Bible with us. And this lady, she owned the shop, the cleaning shop. She believed and study Bible. This lady, the husband abused, and she cried, and she come to the church, and the church do the paperwork for her. And they watch the movie of the Jesus, movie Jesus. Her husband Taiwanese hit her, abused her. And this is a picture of the children. This is a Bible picture. And this lady is the girl. All girls, the Mary of older husband. And this I visit at home, a Taiwanese home, as I stay inside the house. So this is the lady, Vietnamese or Taiwanese. And we need to go to the workshop to work with them. And I teach them how to cut hair. This is my career. And I need to have the job to work. Because they stay home eating, so sometimes the husband will ask them to work to make money. We rent a new room to worship. This is, I need to be visiting the people, I need to use the motorcycle. This is a new building. Okay. This is a new hotel in Vietnam. When they ride out, it's a long thing. They, only few people, but they like to worship together and the building. This lady is the leader of the group, older. We rent a room. And this is a high speed train. This is a return to another city. that you are asking a CP to the capital. This is Pastor Allen. He should be a church in Kaohsiung. This is the pastor in Italian people visiting the jail.
Let's give God the glory with us. The reason we go is because we have not seen the world come to worship God. Worship is the reason that we go. We're seeking for worship. And God has called us to be worshipers. And there are many who haven't heard the gospel and surrendered their life to Christ. And so maybe God is going to prepare you to go. And you'll start something small. In 2013, there'll be another team going to Cambodia and Vietnam, perhaps. And or you can go to Mexico. There's, you know, plenty of opportunities. But the idea here is that because worshipers, God is looking for worshipers. And only true worshipers surrender their lives to Christ. And in spite of all the hardship and difficulties, God is using people like you, and we thank God for Vicky. And many of you prayed and supported, and I know it's difficult because we haven't learned the communication and give her a continuous feedback and so on, but in the future, we need to do better with that. But we're thankful for that. And so I want you to hear the gospel and be reminded that we're not called to enjoy this salvation and our relationship with Jesus for ourselves, but we're called to surrender our life and carry his good news. All right? So let's hear the gospel.
So-called white lie. If you've lied once, you guilty of being a liar? Have you ever taken anything that's not yours? For example, have you ever gone to work late or left early and got paid for it? Have you ever used the boss's telephone or photocopier without asking permission? Or knowingly taken an office pencil home? This is stealing, of course. Most people have taken something that's not theirs, which makes them guilty of being a thief. Now, do you think that God is going to let a bunch of thieving liars like us down? Not likely, because if he did, he'd be the same as the unjust judge who failed to punish the murderer of the one you love. We can't have it both ways. But many people say, wait a minute, I'm a good person. Now there's a big difference between lying and stealing and murder. I've never murdered anyone. But what's interesting is the way Jesus redefined murder. He said that if you hated a person in your heart, you'd murder them in your heart. So here's the last question. Have you ever hated anyone? The truth is that most people have anger or hatred in their heart towards others, which in God's eyes makes us guilty of murder. So you see, this is the bad news. For the sake of justice, there has to be a place called hell. But there is good news, and this is where Jesus Christ comes. The most significant thing that distinguishes Jesus from everyone else is that he is perfect. Unlike us, he's not broken any of God's laws. So he has a perfect record, a perfect soul. Picture the scene before Jesus came to earth 2,000 years ago. Jesus looked forward in time and saw you here today. He turned to God the Father and asked him, Father, I love the people in the world, and I don't want them to go to hell for breaking your laws. Is there a way for them to be forgiven? God the Father looked at his son and said, Jesus, there is one way. Go to earth and become a human being and live a perfect life. Then die a cruel death on a cross to take the punishment that the people in the world justly deserve for breaking my law. When you do this, I can make it possible for them to be forgiven the day when they ask you to exchange their imperfect record for your perfect record. Jesus willingly agreed, and 2,000 years ago, he came to lay down his life for us, to pay the price for all of God's laws that we've broken. And there is no greater love than when someone lays down their life for another. But there is still something that we must do to be forgiven. There are three major events in everyone's life. There's birth and death. Ultimately, we have no control over these. But the third major event is the day when we ask Jesus to forgive us. When we ask Jesus to give us his perfect record. Now, there are some popular misconceptions about this. But in the Bible, God's gift of forgiveness is clear. We're not forgiven by being christened or baptized or confirmed. Not even by praying occasionally or going to church or by believing in God or by trying to be good. These are all good things, but none of them give us forgiveness. Jesus said that there are two things that we must do to be forgiven. The first is that we must be willing to turn away from anything we know is wrong in our life and say sorry to Jesus. Now notice the word willing. There may be some things in your life that you feel powerless to give up in your own strength, like addictions or habits or other complicated things. That's okay, because God will help us as long as we're willing and want to turn away from those things. The second thing we must do is surrender to Jesus. Now, surrender means this. If God made you and the entire universe that surrounds you, don't you think he deserves to be the central person in your life? Surrendering to Jesus is when we acknowledge him as our Savior and humble our lives to him in service. When you were born, it's as though God opened a book about your life. Now bear in mind that God sees everything you do. He knows every attitude, every thought, every motive, and every action. Every time we break just one of God's laws, it's written down in that book. You can imagine that by the end of our lives, there's a whole library written against us. But when you turn and surrender to Jesus, something incredible happens. It's like Jesus takes your book and stands on the top of a cliff and tears out all the pages, the whole record of the things you've done wrong, and he throws them into the deepest sea. He promises to never remember those those things again. Jesus then takes a copy of his perfect record, which you've asked him to give you, and he places it inside the cover of your book with your name on the spine. That book is then stored like a precious library book in heaven. The miracle is that your book is not touched again between the point that you asked Jesus to forgive you and death, even though in that time you may make mistakes and break God's laws again. Becoming a Christian doesn't instantly make you perfect, nor does it mean that you can say a quick prayer and return to your old ways. Remember, God forgave you forever when you asked for Jesus' perfect record. All he asks is that you surrender everything to him and let him daily refine you from your wrongdoing. When you die, you will go before God on Judgment Day, and God will command his angels to get your book. He'll look inside that book and say, "This person was perfect." You will probably say to him, "No, I wasn't. I broke your laws. Don't I justly deserve to go to hell?" And Jesus will say to you, "For the sake of justice, you do deserve to go to hell. You did break my laws, and some you broke many times. But you, my beautiful child, have my perfect record, which I gave you when you turned and surrendered to me on earth, and I forgave you. Welcome to heaven." That is why Jesus is so amazing. He made it possible for everyone in the world, regardless of what mistakes we've made, to be forgiven and to one day enter heaven. But say you never turned and surrendered. Think about what would happen. When you die, you'll go before God in judgment. And God will say to you, "I'm sorry, I can't let you into heaven. I have to send you to hell. You never asked me to forgive you. I loved you so much that I tried six ways to get through to you. First, I died on the cross to take your punishment. Second, someone explained to you in a simple way that you could be forgiven. Third, there were churches throughout the world. Some were good and some I was ashamed of. You could have found the good ones. Fourth, I gave you a conscience so you could tell right from wrong. Fifth, I created a world around you that was so awesome. How could you not wonder about me? And finally, I rose from the dead to prove that I was God and that everything I said was true. But you still did nothing. I'm sorry, I can't let you into heaven. I have to send you to hell. So how about you? If you die tonight, where will you go? Remember, to get to heaven, you need a perfect record, which you could never have unless you ask Jesus to give you his. To receive this free gift, you only have to do two things. First, be willing to turn away from the wrong. And secondly, surrender to Jesus. Unless you do these two things, it's impossible to be forgiven. And at death, it's impossible to get into heaven. Which is so sad. Because this is the very reason Jesus died for you.
Would you please stand? And I just want to give you a 30 seconds to consider your life before God. Would you please bow your head and close your eyes? Lord, I just pray that your Holy Spirit will speak truth to all of us this morning. Convict our heart, Lord. Help us to turn away from sin and surrender our life. And those who have done that, Lord, may they cling to you in the body of Christ and make your name be known. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please have a seat. I just wanted to make sure that you understand that you know, remember the statement that there are churches and some churches that God is ashamed of. And honestly, in today's world, there are Christians that God is ashamed of. And those who are angry, judgmental, homophobic, and condemning. And I have to stand before you and say, I'm sorry. Honestly, that's not what Christians ought to be. And yet the Word of God is very clear that homosexuality is wrong, marriage is for one man and one woman, and that God is holy and perfect. And because of that, we are imperfect people. and we turn and focus our life on a perfect God who paid for our sins. And as we surrender our life and turn away from sin, then the Holy Spirit, the indwelling Holy Spirit, comes and lives in us. As this perfect, holy God, Holy Spirit will then empower us, give us the strength to live for. And so if you make that decision, then you are Christ follower. You're a child of God. And the next step would be to be prepared for baptism. And so I heard one person might be considering studying and getting ready for that. And if you haven't been baptized, then please talk to me. And those of you who make a decision, you say, okay, this is the day I'm ready to turn away from my sin and surrender my life to Jesus and accept his forgiveness. Talk to one of us, the deacons here, or to myself, okay? So please do that. But I want to clarify that because you hear all this on the internet and television, and there is so foggy about this whole concept of God's perfection of holiness and how we as Christ community seems to miss the mark because of few who do not exhibit Christ's love. Okay, so today I wanted to share with you, yesterday, I don't know if you guys was aware, but I was spending time in the sun, as you can see on my face this morning. Now, if you are in the sun, S-O-N, it will be obvious. As I was in the sun yesterday, as you end, I got a suntan, and I think I'm going to pay for it tonight. This morning, I start feeling this burning sensation because I was foolish enough not to put on the suntan lotion at Galveston Beach. But the similarity is the same. If you're in Christ, in the sun, it should show on your face. Okay? So there's no question that if you are a Christ follower, you're in the Son of God, S-O-N, then you have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit and he will empower you to live your life honoring to him. And including as you surrender your life to him, he will make it possible for you to serve him. And maybe not today, but the days ahead in your life. And in fact, not only serving him, but he will empower you, give you the gift, and give you the blessings that you will do so. And you hear a testimony from Ko Vicky that God has allowed her to serve in Taiwan for 2 months. And for all of us, God will, maybe God's not going to call you to do that. Maybe this is right here for this season in your life. Okay, so today we're going to look at the Father's Day series, and we're going to study and honor Father's Day as we're preparing in 2 weeks, right? Okay, how many of you have fathers? Please don't have anybody not raise their hands, because if you don't have any fathers, you're not here, okay? All right, thank you. Everybody should have a father, okay? And so, but I wanted to clarify this, okay? For whatever the reason, if your father's not here, he passed on, or whatever, you need to know and be affirmed that Jesus Christ is the Father to the fatherless and the Mother to the motherless. You need to be encouraged to know that in spite of whatever happened, you know that Christ is your Father, your Heavenly Father. Okay? Last week, we looked at fatherhood in the context of faith, the story of Abraham, right? And then who follows Abraham?
Isaac.
Isaac. And what happened after Isaac? Who followed him?
Jacob.
And then who follows Jacob? Joseph. Okay. But there's other people, but let's remind ourselves in the Genesis series as we study. And all these fathers, men of faith, have put their faith in Christ. Turn to your neighbor and say, faith.
Turn to your neighbor.
Faith. Because why? This is the theme. We read Hebrews last week in Hebrews 11. It's faith. And for them, it's about purity. guaranteed for life. So that's the first message for fatherhood or father-to-be, including if you're mothers and you're ladies here, future mothers, you need to understand that you are called to support and honor and help these guys to be the fathers that God called. Okay? So, but the same principle applies. Purity for life. We talk about the beginning of fatherhood is to put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And from that, God's going to bless you. It's not perfection, right? We saw how messed up Abraham was, and so and so and so. None of those people that we mentioned were perfect. But we know that God is perfect, and God is willing to give us the forgiveness if we turn away from our sins and surrender. Amen. So this is the reality, that we are imperfect. We were created perfect, but sin came and messed up, and now God is perfect. He provided a way for us. If we turn away from our sins, surrender our lives, then we rely on him to help us through and live our lives. That's the reality. Therefore, purity for life is not just for you to hold on until you get married, right? I shared about that last week, right? And frankly, to be honest with you, it's not just for guys. Gals, too. Nowadays, many women are into the internet and going into the temptations of having bad relationships. And frankly, I don't want to use the word, but the P word is pornography. It's not just for guys, but also for gals. And so purity for life is to say, look, you put your faith in God because God is holy. We're not, and we trust in God. That's, if you wanted to start on the right track for fatherhood. So first, purity for life. And so today we're going to look at another component of being a father. How many of you are inspired to be a father one of these days? Okay, good. Because I tell you, a long time I've been praying and waiting for that, and I said, you know, when I was probably in my 20s, and I said, you know, it would be nice to have a little kid, you know, little young Lee Jr. And then when he came, he goes, oh, that was terrible. What did I ask? Why did I ask? He's loud, you know? And so be careful what you wish for. You might end up getting one and have a child. Okay. But the second mark of fatherhood is looking at God characteristics. So remember, one of the things that I think is important for you guys to understand, remember last time we talked about preaching the combined service that we value community, meaningful fellowship, is because God is in community. God is the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And because we're created in the image of God, we value that. And the same thing, we value purity for life is because God is holy and he's perfect. And so we live life so that we please and honor God. There's no place for sin. And if we've messed up, we ask for forgiveness, and he's faithful to forgive us if we repent and turn away from sin. And so that's God's character. He's holy, and therefore we pursue purity. Second characteristics of God to understand, and as we apply for fatherhood, is that God is the one who provides. Jehovah Jireh, right? Jehovah Jireh, my provider, his grace is sufficient for me. Jehovah Jireh, my provider, his grace is sufficient for me. Okay, Jehovah Jireh, that is God's characteristic. He provided. He gives you life. He gives you sustenance. God is our provider. And so as we consider the second qualification or characteristics of fatherhood, you need to understand that God provides and God protects. And so as a father or the father-to-be or the ladies here looking for someone to marry and to be the father of your children, you need to know that the second qualification is provision and protection. What does that mean? Well, God provides and God protects. That means if you are inspired to be a father, you need to consider how you are going to provide and protect for your family. We look at the scripture, you see Abraham, right? Chapter 22. how he and his faith through Isaac surrendered their lives, and then God affirmed it. Later on, Isaac and Joseph. Look at Joseph's life, and that's what we're studying in Genesis, right? He went through his life, and God provided one after the other. And for some of you sitting here, you have no idea what that looked like in another 5 years or 10 years. But I can guarantee you, by the word of God, God will provide for you if you trust in him and put your faith in him. Like Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph, God will do the same for you if you put your faith in God. Sure, you're not going to be rich like Bill Gates and some of those guys, okay? But provision and protection is as simply this, okay? Are you ready? Who's good at math? Who's good at math? Come on, who's good at math?
All Asians.
All Asians. Okay. All right. All Asians, stand up. Stand up. I'm sorry. You guys are such a racist. Come on. All right. Look. The equation is simply this. Okay. What you make is why. Right? Like how many dollars an hour do you make? Is 10 good? What's the minimum wage?
$8.50.
Okay, I used to remember $2.25. That's my first job. That means I'm very old. Okay, so the money you make is Y, okay? You're good at math, so I assume you are. Okay, X is the money you spent, okay? So watch this equation in your brain, because I'm not gonna use a PowerPoint or anything. Look at it, okay? Y minus X. Y is the money that you make, minus X is the money that you spent. Okay, what is left over? No.
Zero.
It equals G squared.
What?
GG.
Great game.
Okay. Great game. Who got that? Saw my Facebook, right? Great game. Y minus X equals G squared. All right, let's go to the scripture. Let's go to the description. 1 Timothy 6, verse 6. The 10th. You guys got it? 1 Timothy 6:16. But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of the world for it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. Verse 9. Those who want to get rich fall into the temptation and attract into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for money, and have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. Little text here is the answer for provision and protection. Guys, it is your responsibility to provide for yourself and your family. It is your responsibility to protect yourself and your family from the enemy. And that means, as a father-to-be, you gotta be thinking through, how do I provide the physical needs? How do I meet the emotional needs? And how do I meet the intellectual needs? And lastly, the spiritual need. And so there's a lot to do. But a lot of people say, well, how am I going to meet even the first need, which is the physical need? And I gave you the answer, right? What is the answer in order to provide for the physical need? Y, Michael, minus X equals G squared. Say that. Say it again. Y minus X equals G squared. Okay, that's Young Lee's equation for saying, that's great gain. How do you do that? Meaning, if you can't have more money, moolah, right? Why? Then you need to deal with the X, right? What is the X? Money spent. Simple. Hard to do. So learn to control your X. Therefore, you have great gain. and say, praise the Lord. Why? Because if you read the text here, those who struggle with the lust of money, right? The focus on the why, let's make more money. Fall into what? The temptation of what? Right? The sin, the greed, and brings to what? Themselves with many what? Griefs. No, the lust of money will bring you griefs. The money that God gives you, you live within the blessing of God, and you learn to control your ex, which is your spending. Now, who gave me a good idea about controlling your money when you go shopping? Huh? How do you stop spending money? Okay, good. Anyone else?
Buy on only use sales.
Only on sales. Yeah, the man after my own heart. Frugal fanatics. Frugal fanatics. Anyone else?
Buy on sale. Ask if you really need it.
Ask, oh, is it a need or a want? Do I need an iPad 3 or 4 or 5 or 6? Or I just don't need it. That's just a want. Remember, God gives you all you need. If you're a child of God, right? The hardest thing for us is we get sucked into the tube and the television to say we have to, I have to, I have to, I have to spend this. And that's not true. And the scripture is very clear. Godliness with what? With what? Contentment is great gain. Say it. Godliness with contentment is great gain. Say it again. Godliness with contentment is great gain. Here's the answer for you, guys and girls. If you want to fulfill God's call for your life, you need to have godliness. That means purity for life. That means putting your faith in God and trust in Him. Whatever God blesses you, remember the story of Joseph, right? One day, he was favored by his father, and then his brothers got jealous and threw him in the that huge, you know, what do you call that?
Well,
pit in the ground, and then he got sold to slavery, and then now he's in prison. And then God continued to provide and bless him. So, consider what you're doing right now. If you're applying for a job, you're not getting no job. Okay? Ask for other people how you can make the money. But don't pursue it and obsess about it. Same thing with your education. Same thing. Because there's a fine line between fulfilling your responsibility to do your work, to study, and there is what we call obsession of trying to pursue money. Why is the lust of money is the root of evil? Because whenever we put something else other than God, that's idolatry. And money can be idolatry. Money is just a mean that God gives us and blesses us to worship Him and use that for the kingdom of God or for your family. And yes, you are called to provide and protect. But you do not worship it. So why don't you stand with me and consider the idea that if you're inspiring to be a father one of these days, the second qualification is that you need to live godliness with contentment. And that you need to lead your life and eventually lead others in your future family to put your trust in God, to rely on His providence, His providing, because our God is Jehovah. Because godliness with contentment is great. And so deal with that in your heart. What is it that the X that you are struggling with? Are you in the red or in the black? Are you in debt dodo or doo-doo or whatever you call that? Or are you living within the resource and the money that you have? And for a lot of the guys, you know, don't even consider thinking about fatherhood if you can't even provide for yourself. Don't even think about that. Why? Because you are not going to fulfill that responsibility. So I'm going to ask you to close your eyes in the next 5 seconds. I want you to talk to God and ask God, what is the next step that we are supposed to do, that you're supposed to do? Let's pray. you, Lord God, for speaking to us. And for some of us here, Lord, we ask for forgiveness because we know that we have failed. We've been enticed and drawn into the temptation and fell for the sin of idolatry of putting money before you. Forgive us, Lord. Help us to turn away from that sin and help us to surrender our lives to you. Thank you, Lord God, for forgiving us, restoring us, and help us to live our lives for you. And Father, I pray for the ladies and the wives here that they would see the incredible privilege and responsibility of their husbands, that they would support and honor, and yes, encourage them to fulfill that responsibility. And Lord, realizing that not all of us have the same resource and opportunities, but let us count our blessings, Lord. Help us, Lord, to see the blessings in the man, the father, that you've given us. Forgive us, Lord, if we are not living our lives the way we are.